Welcome to Actions and Limits. My name is Justin Atherton. I'm a personal coach and the founder of Confidence Unchained. With me as always is Paul Fortune. Paul is a business coach and the founder of A Call to Action. And together we make Actions and Limits. All right, welcome to the show, the podcast where we talk about the actions we can take and the limits we create. Another great guest coming up, Paul. Super excited to have Gabe Howard on the show with us. I know he's going to have a lot of information to share, and I know you and I were checking out his stuff. He's got a pretty good message. What do you think?
Absolutely. Mental health is huge in the world, not just the United States, and we really need to get to the forefront of it. And looking at Gabe's content, he's actually really being a soldier and getting the message out there, and I applaud him for it.
Yeah, let's get right into it. So we'll mention our sponsor first, and then we'll bring Gabe out, because I feel like he's going to have a wealth of information to share with us. So again, our sponsor for the show is Frontline Standard. Frontline Standard Apparel is a veteran and law enforcement-owned patriotic apparel company that's based out of Texas. And if you want more information on Frontline Standard, find them on Instagram and Facebook. They also sell their products on Amazon and Etsy and Pomp USA and GovX. So find them. If you message them directly and mention the show, Actions and Limits Podcast, you can get 35% off your entire order. So let's go ahead and bring out our guest. So Gabe Howard is an award-winning speaker, author, and podcast host who lives with bipolar disorder. He hosts the weekly Psych Central podcast and is the co-host of the Not Crazy podcast. He's the author of Mental Illness is an Asshole and Other Observations. He's appeared on numerous websites, podcasts, and many traditional media outlets, and you can find him online at GabeHoward.com. So let's welcome Gabe Howard to the show. All right, Gabe, welcome to the show. We're really glad to have you on here. Paul and I were watching some of your content, your videos, a lot of interesting ideas you were bringing out there. So go ahead, share a little bit of your story with our viewers and our listeners.
Well, first, Justin and Paul, thank you so much for having me. It's awesome when I can get on somebody else's podcast and I don't have to do any work.
There you go.
I just talk and somebody else has to just handle distribution and graphics. And so this is just a monumental day in Gabe Howard land.
we're glad to have you on our podcast. And yeah, definitely we'll push out your podcast as well to everybody. But
hey, I appreciate that. So my story starts back in 2003 when I was taken to the emergency room because I was suicidal. I was delusional. I was depressed. And when I went there, I didn't even know I was sick. And in fact, the person who asked me, she actually looked me in the eyes and she said, "Are you planning on killing yourself?" And this did not strike me as an odd question. I said yes, because I had thought about suicide for so long that I honestly believed that this was just the natural, normal human condition. I just thought that everybody around me was thinking about suicide. So when she asked me if I was planning on killing myself, this just actually proved in my mind that this was normal. That it was just normal to want to die. And I answered yes. And I was actually excited because I thought now I've got some help. I've got some help, you know, not only carrying out the act, but you know, there was some stuff that I wanted to leave behind and I had planned on leaving it all on my kitchen table and just hopefully people would find it after my death. And now I could have her give it to my mom. And this is really where my brain was. It was really that cavalier. It just, I really was contemplating all of this stuff like one would put together like a Friday evening with their buddies. Like, where should we get pizza? You know, how many drinks should I buy? Like, what should the entertainment, you know, we could play Monopoly, but last time we played Monopoly, you know, Justin, he got mad. Maybe we'll go with Uno this week. It's just that kind of minutia that was going through my brain. And she freaked out and took me to the emergency room where I was admitted to a psychiatric hospital. So within 24 hours, I went from believing that everybody thought about suicide, that I wasn't mentally ill at all, and that everything was fine. And 24 hours later, I'm in a psychiatric hospital where I was diagnosed with bipolar disorder. And I'm just sitting there behind those locked doors, wondering where the hell the ping pong table is. And it was just that quick. Just that quick.
For our viewers, many of them don't know what bipolar is. Can you explain that to us?
Yeah. So bipolar disorder is the easy and sort of accepted answer to this question is bipolar disorder is extreme highs, which is the mania, and extreme lows, which is your depression. And it's vacillating back and forth. Now I always add a little bit because sometimes people hear, oh, you're either so depressed you want to die by suicide, or you're so manic you think you're like an invincible god. And those two extremes are true. Please don't not hear that that's absolutely true. But you are vacillating back and forth on that spectrum, which means that you're at any point on the spectrum, including, and this is the most important part, including perfectly normal, perfectly typical, perfectly just average. And in many ways, that's kind of the most damaging part of bipolar disorder, because when you're right in the middle, when you're normal, when you're average, when you're typical, you know, that's when you get the job. That's when you meet the girl. That's when you buy the house. That's when you marry the girl. You know, all the things that you lose when you become symptomatic. And more importantly, people see you in that space. So when you start to act erratic, you know, grandiose, manic, and just insane, for lack of a better word, and when you start to act depressed and anxious and unreliable, people always kind of remember when you're in that middle space, and they're like, "What the fuck is wrong with Gabe? Why is he doing this? Well, he's just a jerk." And I understand that, because who are they going to believe? You or their lying eyes? They've seen you be normal, so they know you can do it, and here you are. It's kind of a mess of an illness.
Yeah, and it's a little bit scary thinking about that, how, you know, how something like that can go undiagnosed for so long. And what's interesting, and I wonder, the question that she asked you, you know, are you thinking about killing yourself? If you talk to anybody, I mean, you know, crisis negotiations and people that deal with that, that is the question to ask.
Yes.
And yeah, it's not like you don't want to kill yourself. Like, don't talk them out of it. She asked the perfect question for someone that is suicidal.
I often talk about just how lucky I am. And, you know, for a guy who woke up in a psychiatric hospital, who was diagnosed with bipolar disorder, who wanted to kill himself for a quarter of a century, people are like, wait, you consider yourself lucky? And I do. I do, because I ran into somebody who not only noticed something was wrong. I mean, that's like number one. She's like, hey, something's wrong here. But number two, she decided, hey, I'm going to do something about it, which is pretty unusual. But three, and most importantly, she knew what to do. And when it comes to suicidality and mental illness and bipolar disorder and psychosis and depression, and all, the number of people who have no idea what to do vastly, vastly outweigh the number of people who do know what to do. So I was just extraordinarily lucky to run into the right person. And the luck compounds from there. You know, I was lucky that the emergency room knew what to do. I was lucky that there was a bed available. I was lucky that I had insurance. I was lucky that I had money. I was lucky that I was in a big enough city that had not only a psychiatric ward, which you can pretty much find in every single town, but it had like support groups and outpatient treatment and good access to psychiatry and psychology. And that's the advantage of living in a big city, right? It was abundant and I could afford to pay for it. Luck, 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 luck. And finally, I have an engaged and caring and loving family. And I did not think that was luck, but looking around the mental health landscape and people with mental illness, they have long since been abandoned by, forgotten by, or just their families are just worn out and they don't have those people anymore. So even that last little thing, my mom and dad love me, luck. It's it's so striking to think that the only reason I'm here is because I just like, I don't know. I just consistently rolled the right number in craps. I didn't earn it. I just got lucky. So, go Gabe.
So Gabe, after 03, you know, the awareness of the bipolar disorder, take us through your journey to where you're at now.
So first, obviously I had to be diagnosed with bipolar disorder, and that was terrifying, but it answered a lot of questions. It answered a lot of questions, not only for me, and it put things in perspective for me, but it really started, it had this ripple effect among my family. My mom once told me, she goes, wow, you know, I'm reading this stuff on bipolar disorder, and I got to tell you, I always called you my Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde child. Mm. And I'm just like, mom, you're literally describing bipolar disorder. But of course, she just had no idea. I think that people, whenever I tell my story, they always think that I'm going to like zig to the left and tell people like how shitty my mom was, or how my dad was an alcoholic, or how my family wasn't close, or, but I have none of that. I always say the worst thing that my parents ever did to me was have my brother and my sister. Like, I think I could have dug being an only child. but seriously, there was a lot of support and love, and we went on vacation together. And I always joke, we even ate dinner together. Ooh. As a family. And you know as well as I do, you read on the internet, they're like, the downfall of America is that people don't eat dinner together. Well, we did, and still bipolar. So I only say this because so many people want to find something to hang their hat on other than bipolar disorder is an illness. Mm-hmm. It is a biological brain-based disease. And sometimes, no matter how hard you try and how much the people around you love you, and even though you're doing all of the right things, sometimes you get an illness that you don't want and has devastating results on you. And, yeah, and that's where I was. So when I left the hospital, I say that began my 4-year epic battle with mental illness. And it took 4 years. It took 4 years to find the right medication. It took 4 years to find the right coping skills. It took 4 years to learn how to manage the disorder with the medication and know when trouble was coming and get ahead of it. There was a lot of trial and error. That's just, yeah, the way mental illness is treated. And it took 4 years to reach recovery. And we can drill down into that as far as you want, but the bottom line is, from the time I was diagnosed until the time that I reached recovery, and I define recovery as spending more time living my life than I do managing bipolar disorder, took 4 years. And that's really where I am today. I'm in the living my life phase, but I'm also in the giving back phase, because I being in the hospital, I was so alone. I could not think of anybody with bipolar disorder, mental illness, who is doing well. I mean, it was just horror story after horror story after horror story.
Sure.
And when I got well, I just thought, man, I just don't want the next person diagnosed to have to be so alone. And once again, enter luck. I am lucky that I am a gigantic, loud guy whose family was okay with this. You know how many families would be like, dude, shut up, get off the internet. Don't tell people this. Don't tell them how we messed up. Don't tell them that you're sick. They're going to blame me. My family was like, tell our story, just loud as you can. Apparently we don't have scruples. I don't know, but that's just more luck. I look at some of my other advocates and they're just like, yeah, my mom won't talk to me anymore. She says I embarrass the family. My mom's in the front row screaming.
when you're sharing that, and in case you don't know our backstory, myself, I have a career in law enforcement. So through my career, I've dealt with a lot of people with mental illness. I've seen people commit suicide and dealt with people that are homeless and have, you know, some form of mental illness. And with you sharing that, it's making me think that it's not some kind of traumatic or horrible home that creates the mental illness, but you having that support system for you let you get a way out and find another path to go, rather than, you know, living in some type of disturbed home and you have a mental illness and then you're cast out on the street or people can't understand what's going on or they don't have the money to deal with it. And then it gets worse, right? Because if you don't deal with it and you don't have the ability to cope with those things, then it gets worse.
It really is a snowball effect. And there's so much of what you said that, you know, again, trying to like pull it all out would take like hours upon hours. Sure. So I want to be the first to say that the discussion that we're having and the answer that I'm about to give is in no way complete. But one of the reasons that I say that I'm lucky is because, well, let's consider, you know, I did a lot of really messed up things. When I was not being treated and I didn't even know that I was sick, you know, I abused drugs and alcohol. I drove really fast. I jumped off a roof. So I'm really, really lucky for two reasons. One, as I just said, I abused drugs. Well, drugs were illegal back in 2003 and they're mostly illegal in 2020. So the fact that I don't have a criminal record is just luck. Right. I'm lucky that I didn't use drugs and walk outside and meet, you know, somebody who has a background in law enforcement. And there was some luck to that. Right. I'm lucky that all of those times that I decided, you know, that I was manic and I decided, hey, I've got a nice car. Let's go 100 miles an hour. That one, I didn't kill myself. Two, I didn't kill anybody else. And, you know, I didn't get pulled over for going 100 miles an hour. I luck, I guess. I don't know. But to your point about how things snowball, they really do. I was, you know, let's go back to my close-knit family. I hid a lot of stuff from them. Sure. And they didn't know a lot of, especially when I was an adult. You know, I wasn't diagnosed until I was 25 years old. So from, you know, I moved out at 18. So 18 to 25, it's easy to lie to your parents. Let's just call a spade a spade. It's easy to lie to your parents. How are things going? Things are going great. I'm doing fantastic. They're not running background checks on you. You're grown. You live elsewhere. I also had a good job and a house and a nice car. So my parents were like, oh, he must be doing well, because after all, people who are doing well have nice cars and own homes. And so it's really easy to hide, right? But yeah. I'd like to point out that they were calling. So even though I knew that I was lying by omission to my mom, I still felt guilt. You know, every time my mom would call and be like, what'd you do this weekend? And I knew the answer was a whole bunch of hookers and passed out. That's what I did this weekend. I would lie to her and say, oh, I went out with my friends. I saw a concert, which was loosely true. You know, sex workers can be friends. There was live music. But I felt like a tremendous amount of guilt about it. So even though my mother could never intercede because I lied to her, the fact that she was engaged in my life, mm-hmm. it raised the, I don't even know how to put it. Just the very fact that my mom, my grandma, my dad, my brother, my sister, they would just call me. I think, oh, I got to do better. Now, here's where the illness is really mean. No matter how hard I try to do better, I couldn't. So again, here's where I talk about luck again. Finally, somebody got me a doctor because, you know, so now I've got it. So I was able to hang on long enough to get to a doctor because I had an engaged family who they were helping me, even though they didn't even realize that I was sick. They didn't even realize they were helping me. But now let's remove all of this. Let's say that they did know what was going on and they just threw their hands up and said, oh my God, my son is an alcoholic whoremonger. I don't even know what's wrong with him. We're so ashamed, because the things that I was doing were deeply shameful. I was ashamed of them. My family would have been ashamed of them if they knew. So they abandoned me. And then let's say I lost my job and then I had no money. So then I decided to like shack up with another Gabe who's also lost all of his support system. So now Gabe and Gabe, you know, our mental illnesses, our drug addictions, our alcohol addictions, our desperation, our loneliness is just fueling this synergy of just, I don't know, despair.
Yeah.
And on and on. And then finally, before you know it, you're homeless and you're addicted to drugs and and then your brain is just rattled, partly because of mental illness, partly because of drug addiction. And as we know in society, we step over homeless people constantly and we don't give a shit. They're just the annoying people that ask us for change. We have so far not been swayed by the idea that humans are sleeping on the streets. And the only thing that kept me from being one of those people was frankly just luck. I just luck. And you can just dig so much deeper, you know, it's just, sure. It's so scary.
Gabe, if you could have a conversation with your younger self, what would you tell yourself?
Oh, dude, I go to a doctor. I think about this a lot. That on one hand, I always laugh when I get this question, because like there's like a part of me that's like, oh, what a stupid question. But then there's another part of me that knows damn well it's not a stupid question, because what could somebody have said to me that would have made me wake up? Because yeah. Like I said, people were talking to me. I think that if I could honestly sit my younger self down, I would give him the mental health talk. I would probably say something along the lines of, hey, are you thinking about suicide? Do you know what suicide is? Do you understand that suicidality is a symptom of an illness? Do you know why you're thinking about this? I would ask like very deep emotional questions that frankly, my family just didn't ask. My family was very, very close, but like so many American families, we weren't having like deep emotional talks. You know, my dad would give me the pat on the arm, I'm proud of you, son. He wouldn't give me the big hug, I love you, crying. I'm not insulting him for that at all. I knew my father loved me and I knew he was proud of me, but never once did he ask me if I was depressed. He never asked me if I would, you know, he told me to hold open doors and be nice to women and talk less. and he taught me, you know, the value of like hard work and to save some money. And, you know, when I got married to my first wife, he gave me this whole big speech about being a good husband. Like these were the things that were very valuable to my father as far as values concerned. Mm-hmm. But the thing that almost killed me was that he never said, hey, are you planning on killing yourself? To which there's only two answers to that question. Yes, I am. In which case you help somebody immediately, or no, why the hell would you ask me that?
Yeah.
And so those conversations were all missing. So to answer your question, Paul, I would talk to my younger self about suicidality, depression, loneliness, anxiety, desperation. And obviously I know myself, so I would talk to myself about why I cry at night. And these are things that nobody ever discussed with me. And that led me to believe either I was just really, really, I was just a very shameful person. I was very ashamed of the fact that I cried all the time. I didn't think it was manly. And two, it made me think that some other thoughts that I were having were very normal. And this prevented me from getting care for a very long time. And luckily it all turned out okay for me. But I think about the number of things that could have gone wrong before I finally got to the hospital, whether it would have been, my own suicide, or whether it would have been, you know, the roof that I jumped off, I landed on grass. It was only like a story and a half. I was a big fat guy. I survived. But you hear stories all the time of people, they're not trying to kill themselves. They just honestly believe that from the fourth story, they can jump into the pool and all of their friends will think that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, they hit the pool and die instantly. It's not suicide though. It's a different mechanism that frankly isn't discussed either. So that's what I would talk to my younger self about. And I just plead with him to get help.
I think your message is, I think your message is so important, you know, what you're putting out there, because like you said, with your own family, no one knows how to have these conversations. You know, whether you're recognizing that someone might be in emotional distress, or because sometimes we ignore that. We're like, oh, they're just going through something. Just let them deal with it. You know, they'll get out of it. And especially with bipolar, you come out of it, what seemingly, right? You know, and you're like, hey, oh, he's better. He's not depressed yeah. anymore. And so your family members shut it off and go, oh, he's fine now. You know, he was just in a little slump, but we don't know how to talk about it. And, you know, there's, again, you know, talking about law enforcement, suicide is one of the top killers of law enforcement, because we don't want to talk about it. You know, it's faux pas. It's against what we think about. It's being weak, you know, but we don't want to ask that question. Hey, are you thinking about killing yourself?
Because I do a lot of work with police officers and the crisis intervention training. CIT is what it's known nationally.
Yes.
And it's, and it, one of its biggest flaws, and I hope the CIT people don't hear me, but its biggest flaw is that they love to talk about how law enforcement can understand people like me, understand where we're coming from, understanding what tools to use to get the best outcome when dealing with, you know, Gabe, who is manic or thinks there's aliens in the room or, you know, suffering from psychosis or suicidality, et cetera. But what they never talk about is what if the police officer or the law enforcement person is feeling this way? Yeah. And now don't get me wrong. We've got to start somewhere. I'm very happy with what's out there. And also, unfortunately, in America, if I am extraordinarily symptomatic, it's law enforcement who's going to come to help me. I'm having a medical crisis mm-hmm. and law enforcement comes. I always joke, you know, what next? Like, if you're having a heart attack, they send law enforcement. Or what if somebody robs a bank? They send EMTs. It's kind of a messed up system that we have here.
Yeah.
But agree. Nevertheless, it's our system. But to your point, yeah, you're a human. Law enforcement. I'm trying to collect my thoughts here, but law enforcement makes up a large, there's lots and lots of police officers. That's what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. And when you get enough police officers, when you get enough of anybody, mental illness is going to be present because it's just the law of averages. If you have 100,000 people in the room, by definition, some tiny percentage of those people are going to have mental illness. And then they're in a culture where we sort of talk about, you know, you've got to be tough, you've got to be strong, don't show weakness. And I think that message is probably a good message for, like, policing. You know, obviously, if you're running down a criminal, yeah, probably crying is not your best bet. I get it. You know, it's like dealing with children, right? You need to be firm and consistent, consistent. And I know I'm butchering law enforcement here, but let's look at when we tell parents you need to be fair and consistent and firm, we never, or at least we shouldn't be telling parents that when the children aren't in the room, if you think you made a mistake, you should discuss it with other parents. You should discuss it with, if you feel that you're getting overwhelmed by your children, you should discuss it with your partner or other parents. We don't have that same message for law enforcement. No. If you're getting overwhelmed by your job, it's a grin and bear it. But this is dangerous not only for law enforcement, because obviously, as we've seen with the suicide rates, this is dangerous for law enforcement. But now let's look at it from the public's point of view. Do we really want somebody who is overwhelmed, stressed out, and considering suicide to be policing us? That's like a scary proposition. So I really think that we all need to come together, because I think it's beneficial for society. Sure. It's beneficial for the individual law enforcement officer. It's beneficial for the people who are being policed. It's just beneficial all the way around. And it's sad. It's really sad that it takes conversations like this outside. Like, I would love to see police departments get on board with mental health training just in the academy.
Yeah. No, I think that would be,
it's still being avoided.
Yeah.
Not there, everywhere. Not
there
everywhere.
Are some. Yeah. There are some classes out there, and I took one last year. It was a guy that came in. It was really, man, I wish I could remember his name right now, but it's like his mission to go out and talk about, you know, veterans and police officers with, you know, depression and with suicidal thoughts. And he has got a really powerful story about his own suicidal ideation. He puts on a 16-hour course, you know.
Oh, wow.
But again, it's like, that should be taught like in the academy before you're exposed to all this stuff, not 10 years, 15 years later. And it was like, you know, the baggage you're carrying around. Yeah. We'll help you unpack some of that. Yeah. You know?
I really think we're getting there. And I know that it's a slow process, and I really wish that we could like turn it off instantly. But I have to tell you, since I became an advocate really in like 2007, 2008, and obviously I started moving up, but I was like, I was 100% all in Gabe Howard in 2010. So there's been a hard decade of this. Yeah. And back in 2010, when I started doing CIT, it was like this. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your time. Thank you. Do you have any questions? I mean, okay, we'll ask one. You look polite. And now, 10 years later, we have to stop. Like we it's like, I'm sorry, Gabe is out of time. Gabe has to go. And we've lengthened the amount of time that I have, and we've brought in like other panels. There's, you know, I'm not the only person. I'm not the only lived experience person, the only lived experience speakers. We have panels, and, but it went from an hour that we had trouble filling to 3 hours. And we're still telling, we're still telling officers, look, we have to hard stop. We have a lot to get to. Sure. And I think that that is very, very, I think that's indicative of a lot of progress, because the Q&A is what is stretching it. And that's driven by the officers. Mm-hmm. That's not driven by Gabe running his mouth. That's driven by the officers. And I'm very hopeful for that. Now I only do it in one small place in Ohio, so maybe all the other states suck. I don't know. But based on what I see, I think it's getting better. I meet a lot more Justins now, than I did a decade ago. So,
Gabe, what about medications? Are we medicating too much, too little? What do you see about that? Because I know you should have an opinion on that.
Hey, I have opinions on everything. If you want to talk about the best ice cream, we can go to town. So medication is one of those, it's one of those sticky wicket conversations, right? So the first thing that I want to say is, anybody who says big pharma, stop listening to them. They're done. They're, you know, just, well, big pharma's awful. Yeah. The minute they get cancer, they're signing up for all the big pharma stuff. So it just, that has always irritated me. It's sort of like, I'm not saying that the pharmaceutical companies never make a mistake or don't have issues. I'm not sure how I feel about things like advertising. I think there's a lot to discuss on their side, but there's a big difference between having a discussion about policies and promotions and how we're discussing medications in the grant and prescribing them. That's a far cry from vilifying the person that you're debating, right? So that always bugs me when I hear any mental health advocate say, well, you can't trust big pharma. Come on, man. They're the only game in town. If I didn't have my medication, I'd be homeless tomorrow. Mm. That said, that doesn't retroactively make them 100% perfect. I always use the example of my wife. I love my wife. She is one person, and I picked her out of all the people that I could find. I don't agree with everything that she says and does. So I'm probably not going to agree with everything that a $1 billion corporation does.
Sure.
So that's the first thing that I want to say. Medication is a very private matter between a patient like me and my prescriber, my doctor. And I want both sides to have all the information. I want patients to feel empowered to ask questions, to make complaints, to talk about side effects, to say things like, I don't want this medication anymore. I'm not going to take it, and I want your help finding a better medication. And on the prescriber side, I want them to stop saying things like, oh, I can't get my patient to be med compliant. I hate that phrase, that if people with mental illness would just be med compliant, we wouldn't have any problems, because that's nonsense. Med compliancy only works if you have been prescribed the correct medications. So I can't help but notice that every time we discuss med compliancy, we always put everything on the patient. It's the mentally ill guy's fault. It's never the doctor's fault. It's never society's fault. It's never, nope. It's only the mentally ill guy's fault.
Gabe, what is
I'd like to point that out.
Gabe, what is mentally compliant? What does that mean?
Med compliant med compliant just means taking your medication as prescribed. There's okay. This idea in the world that whenever somebody with mental illness is acting up or has a crisis or is symptomatic, that it's because they're not taking their meds. And you hear that phrase all the time. It's like, oh, well, you know, Gabe got angry and started kicking a door and the police were called, was not med compliant. Look, that may well be true. That statement in and of itself could be true. But it's actually more likely that Gabe was perfectly med compliant and the medications either didn't work or had a side effect that nobody anticipated. Like, I don't know, made Gabe really angry or kept Gabe up for 3 days straight or pushed Gabe into psychosis. We never talk about how the medication can cause issues. We like to believe that medication is just 100% perfect, and it's not. Now, the correct medication is a beautiful thing. Once you're on the right medications and you get the right care, then you can lead the same life that everybody has. I live with bipolar disorder, but listen, I live in the same block, the same house, the same wife. I mean, I'm doing all the stuff that all the other 43-year-olds are doing because I have the right medication. But it took 4 years to find the correct medications. And if you ask anybody in society, they believe that these medications are easy to prescribe, easy to find. And if you are not on them, it's because you're lazy. And I haven't even talked about the fact that some people can't even afford them. Sure. Or can't afford a doctor or can't get access to care. I am pretending in this scenario that everybody is Gabe Howard, has access to a doctor, can afford the medications. But yeah, there's just a lot of pressure.
What about Eastern medicine? Is there things that we can adopt from Eastern medicine that would help mental illness?
So, you know, sort of. First off, I'm a big firm believer in the toolbox theory of medical care. And I always give this example. Take your house or your apartment and list all of the things that make your house like a fully functional house, right? Like you probably got a roof, right? A roof is really important, right? And you've got plumbing. And you've got electric, and you've got internet, and you've probably got like carpeting and paint and some decorations. Now, imagine if somebody came in and told you that you had to like figure out which is the most important. And you're probably thinking to yourself, okay, well, you know, if the walls weren't painted, I could probably survive, but then it'd kind of be ugly. You start to get in this argument inside your own head. Well, I definitely need water. I mean, I got to flush a toilet. Well, but then again, if I didn't have electric, I couldn't see the toilet. But how would I shower? I'd get bed sore. I couldn't wash my clothes. Well, I could go to the gym. But if you really stop and think about it, this is just like a really stupid discussion. You need all of these things to feel comfortable in your own house. When it comes to, you know, Eastern medication and diet and exercise and yoga and lighting candles or medication, et cetera, the bottom line is you need all of the things to be well. And whatever that looks like for you, Gabe Howard is 100% in support of. Now, I want to put a little asterisk on that. And people are constantly writing me and saying, I told my doctor to go fuck himself. I'm going off all my medications and I'm just smoking weed from now on. Yeah, don't do that. Don't do that. And you can replace weed with anything. You know, candles, cannabis oil, yoga, diet and exercise. Just please, please work with your doctor. This idea that doctors are evil and trying to hurt you, there's really only two, maybe there's a couple of possibilities here, but one, if you really believe that your doctor is that bad and you can switch doctors, report your doctor, find out why you believe that, investigate this out. Because if you really are seeing a doctor that does not have your best interest in mind, that's medical malpractice and that's a real big problem. But it's also possible that maybe you and your doctor just don't understand each other. Find a way to understand, find a way to get on the same page. And listen, I want to empower you as a patient to ask for a nurse or a patient advocate or a consumer advocate or talk to the office manager and say, look, I really, really want to work with Dr. Bob, but I don't feel that Dr. Bob understands me. Can you help? And hopefully they can help. You know, fight for that. Just fight in the same way that if your car had 1,000 miles left on its warranty in one day and the something went out of it, but you couldn't bring it in until 2 days after the warranty expired. You're like, no, it broke on Tuesday. The warranty expired on Wednesday. I just had to pick up my kid from daycare, so I'm bringing it in on Thursday. Fight that hard. Like, fight that hard, because this is your health. Mm-hmm. So many people believe that they just have to accept whatever the doctor says and leaves. That's not true. And that's one of the educational points over on the medical side. It's no longer doctor's orders anymore. It's doctor's recommendations. Yeah. And we need to understand that.
I like that, because there's people now being those medical advocates for people, because we're trained to just listen to the doctors, right? And you're like, oh, well, they said so. So, you know, we're just going to go with it. You know, it's not that they're trying to harm you. They just might, it's practicing medicine, right? Yeah. You know, they're trying to figure it out. Like you said, it took you 4 years to figure out your right medication. They were practicing and messing with the doses and getting it right. And you stuck with it long enough that they got it right. You know?
Yes. Everything that you said is true, but I really think that many patients come in with a misconception that this is supposed to be quick and easy. Yeah. And I think it's because of things like all you have to do is take your medicine and you'll be fine. I think that there's just it's portrayed poorly in pop culture. I always use Homeland as an example. Homeland, one of the main characters has bipolar disorder. And when she's well managed, she's brilliant, of course, because we're all brilliant when we're managed, I guess. And so she'll start acting erratic. She'll be like, I'm erratic. And Paul will say, Homeland lady, have you taken your medicine? I have not. And then Homeland lady will take her medicine and then she'll prevent terrorism. Just like that. Just within 10 minutes later in the show, she is perfect. Listen, that's barely how aspirin works for a headache. I mean, that's just, we're talking about something as serious, as severe and persistent mental illness that there is no cure for and that you will have for life. And it is portrayed on television and it is believed by the general population that it can be controlled by like a single pill that is rooting around your glove box in your car. That's just nonsense. These are sort of the educational points that we have to get out there. I understand why people believe this, but stop it. But yeah. The problem is if society believes it, then the patient believes it on day one.
Sure.
And that's the part that we have to get away from. Listen, Gabe Howard believed it on day one. Luckily, I was very, very fortunate to be able to get like a lot of support groups that had other people with bipolar disorder. I had a lot of people around me like, listen, this is the way it works. You're going to get no. And when I would say the things like, they're just throwing pills at me. They're like, what do you want them to do? A lobotomy? Well, no. Well, what surgery on your brain? No, that sounds bad. Well, then I guess we're back to pills.
Mm-hmm.
Huh. I had people around me to help. Yeah. Not everybody.
The support system is key.
Yeah.
It's super key.
Big time key.
I love the title of your book, you know, Mental Illness is an Asshole. How did you come about that? I mean, you're very passionate about the idea, but what brought you to that title and writing that book?
Oh, the book is a collection of articles. It's 380 pages long, and it's a collection of articles that I wrote over a 5-year period, all kind of indexed into categories and sections and trends. And one of the articles that I wrote a long, long time ago was called Mental Illness is an Asshole. Now, I wrote it because I write for the internet primarily. 90% of what I write goes online. I've written very few for, you know, what a lot of people call dead tree media. But you know, the internet is a weird place, and the internet works by something called keywords. And all the way back in like 2014, somebody wrote an article called My 3-Year-Old is an Asshole, and it went viral. And then because it went viral, people started writing all kinds of other articles like my husband is an asshole, the mechanic is an asshole, the police officer that directs traffic outside of my kid's school is an asshole. It really just every little thing that ever, you know, the McDonald's worker is an asshole. So fill in the blank is an asshole just became like a trend on the internet for sure. Just, you know, these things only last like a month. So I wrote Mental Illness is an Asshole. Mostly because I just wanted to take advantage of the SEO, of the search engine optimization, of the trend of people Googling, of people finding it. And that's why I wrote it. All these years later, I get a publisher. I want to publish a book. And the guy says, listen, we're going to call it Mental Illness is an Asshole. And I said, no, that's a bad idea. I don't think that's a good idea. And the guy's like, listen, just, the world is not the same as it used to be. One of the most popular books out there about emotions and discussing emotions and emotional response is called Fuck Feelings. That's the honest to God title of the book. Now they do star it out. It's F star star K feelings, but that's what convinced me. He's like, look, that book has the F word in it. Your book just has asshole. So I agreed, and it's been great. The dude was right. I mean, he publishes books for a living. I'm just some schlub that accidentally wrote one, I guess. But it opens up conversations, and you know, the article itself just really likens mental illness. It turns mental illness into a person, and it describes that person as an asshole. And the very last line in the whole thing is, it's hard to be on the lookout for mental illness but I'm always on the lookout for assholes. Because we are. Anybody who screwed us over, we know when they're in the room. We know when they're circling around. We know when they're looking at us. And it's that kind of vigilance that keeps them from hurting us again, whether it's in the workplace, et cetera. We even have asshole family members. It's like, I'm not going to be alone in the room with my cousin. Yeah, she's crazy. You know, things like that. So the whole thing went over very, very well. And people just like it because mental illness is scary.
Yeah,
it's very, very scary. And people are looking for reasonable information that they can understand. But, you know, the reality is nobody lies awake at night and thinks, I wonder if I'm having a mental health crisis. I wonder if my mental health is suffering. I wonder if I could have a mental illness as diagnosed by a doctor from the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, version 5. I should see a psychiatrist. No, people lie awake at night and wonder if they're crazy. They wonder if they're going nuts. They wonder if they're insane. These are the thoughts that drive people to treatment and to care. And I think it's time that we start talking that way so that people can recognize that, hey, this guy gets it. And then when they get to me, I'll give them a little bit of information. I'll help them out. And then finally, I'll say, all right, now you've got like a foundation. Go to a doctor. And that will empower them to move forward and to be a good healthcare consumer and get the help they need. I just sometimes feel like we just kind of tiptoe around it and walk on eggshells. And then Justin hears it and Justin's like, oh, well, I don't think I'm having a mental health issue. I don't even know what that is. But maybe Justin hears I'm going nuts. And he thinks, man, sometimes I think that too. And then Gabe and Justin and Paul can have a good conversation and get Justin the help he needs because I'm using the words that Justin understands.
Yeah. That's super powerful, Gabe.
I'm doing it for you too, Paul.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Thumbs up.
Yeah.
I think you got a really good message and you're putting it out there in a way that people can, you know, get what's going on and confronting that issue on not wanting to speak up. So I think that's super powerful message. And I think you're going to be touching a lot of people. I'm sure you've already helped plenty of people already.
I hope so.
With the idea of the Actions and Limits podcast. So like what would be an action that you could tell our viewers and our listeners that they could take, you know, along this path, whether it's for themselves or whether it's for, you know, a family member, friend.
Listen, one of the first actions that I'm going to take is I firmly believe that if you think something's wrong, you're probably right. So many people tell me, hey, I think I might be having a mental health issue, a mental health crisis, or I might be going insane. I think I'm going crazy. I have so much anxiety. I can't move. What do I do? And I always say, you know, go to a doctor, make an appointment with your general practitioner, make an appointment with a therapist, make an appointment with somebody and talk to them. And they fire back, what if I'm wrong? That's fantastic. If you think you have cancer, you'd go to a doctor. And if you find out that you don't, that'll be the happiest day of your life. Who cares if you're wrong? Mm-hmm. We have to start treating mental health issues exactly how we would treat physical health issues. And get a tune-up, get a checkup. It's the therapy can be the literal equivalent of getting a yearly physical. You know, just talk to somebody, work it out, and make sure you're on the same page. I often say, listen, just because you're seeing a therapist doesn't mean that you're Gabe Howard. It doesn't mean that you have bipolar disorder. It doesn't mean that you've had psychosis. It doesn't mean that you need to go to the hospital or be institutionalized or on and on. There's so much myth and misunderstanding that you're either perfectly healthy or you're like, you need to be institutionalized for the rest of your life. There's a whole swath of in there that you can't ignore or you might end up over on this side.
Sure.
So just... that's the action that I would take. If you suspect it, trust your gut. You're probably right. There's a reason that you're suspecting it. Call a provider. Don't be ashamed of it. Like for real, don't be. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. Like honestly, I was on a path to death. Now I'm on a path to marriage. I don't know.
And with the other half, you know, what are some limits that, you know, you see that we place on ourselves in that perspective?
That I kind of hit it on the first one. You know, one of the limits is we have so much shame surrounding it. Mm. We decide that going to a doctor means we're weak. And I got to tell you, the people that tell me that going to a doctor or going to a therapist or discussing your emotions or feelings or even crying makes you weak, that absolutely astounds me. And here's why. Society tells you not to do those things. and you listened. You, society told you to get on your knees and you said yes, because you're strong, I guess. I just, when society tells you to do something and you say no, that sounds like bullshit to me. I'm going to take care of myself. I'm going to talk about my emotions. I'm going to talk about my feelings. I'm going to get help so that I can live my best life. I don't care what the rest of you, you're literally pressing back against decades of just toxic garbage and saying, you know what? I'm going to do what's best for me. That seems really strong to me.
Yeah.
There's an old Saturday Night Live. Remember Jack Handy from the 90s?
Yeah,
and he did that. It said it takes a big man to cry, and it takes an even bigger man to laugh at that man. It always kind of stuck with me, because we've always said this, it takes a big man to cry. Well, think about that. They're literally saying that you have to be so tough and so badass that you're willing to cry. Well, just, I'm not saying, you know, run around and start crying in a McDonald's. I don't want people to hear that message, but you know, participating in the status quo and calling that strength, that's not what strength is. That's just going along with the lemmings. That's just following the masses. Pushing out of that system and taking care of yourself, or taking care of others and encouraging other people to do it, that, in my opinion, is real strength. And I hope that message catches on. I hope so too, Gabe. It's really the biggest thing that kept me going, because I heard all the garbage too. I heard it all too. You know, men are supposed to be, you know, the strong, silent type and tough. And I really felt like I was being weak until I realized, wow, I am capable of doing stuff that these guys can't even get off the couch and do. I think I'm gonna be okay.
Yeah.
But it took me a while to realize that. That was not an instant thing. And I've earned the respect of people around me for doing so. And I, you know, I my father is a retired truck driver. You know, I grew up in the rub mud on it if you cut yourself. And you know, my dad's a tough guy. He taught me to fight when I was like 7. I'm like, Dad, I don't need to fight anybody. He's like, get this phone book. But yeah,
for that one day you'll need it.
Yeah. Like, one day you'll need to defend yourself. I'm like, against who? that day has not come yet, but I'm ready to hit a phone book if the phone book attacks me.
Well, Gabe, I think what you're doing is great. Really educating people out there on mental illness and how we can, you know, change the conversation that we're having around that. And I think that's really powerful. What's a good way for our viewers and listeners to look you up, get a hold of you, you know, check out your content?
Yeah, the best way, like the single way, is to go to GabeHoward.com. Everything that you can possibly want is on GabeHoward.com. I know y'all like podcasts because, you know, you're listening to one now. You can check out the Not Crazy podcast or the Psych Central podcast. There are two different shows. I host one, I co-host another. They both have a different flair, but they're of course both mental health shows. And of course, both are featured over at GabeHoward.com.
Awesome.
Everything you want is there.
Well, Gabe, thank you so much for sharing your insight. Keep doing what you're doing, man. Your mission is good with a great cause. And I feel like you're going to end up affecting a lot of people's lives and really changing that conversation that we have around mental health. And hopefully you can expand for those classes that you're teaching just in your state, you know. Get out and expand to all those other states that you said are sucking it up right now.
what I said exactly was, I don't know what these other states are doing, because I'm not there. But I gotta tell you, I do watch the news, and there does seem to be some suck. That's all I know. No.
I get it. Again, Gabe, thank you so much for coming on the show. Pleasure to chat with you, and man, keep doing what you're doing, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
All right. Paul, what a wealth of information. Man, Gabe's on a mission for putting out his message. I give him a lot of credit for being able to put his story out there in that way, and to be able to, you know, affect so many people's lives. That's great.
Yeah, and he's able to use humor and a positive attitude about it. And I think that's very, very important because you're talking about serious illness that a lot of people suffer from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just being able to be like, yeah, you know, this is what I have. Like, don't shy away from it. Don't be embarrassed about it. But get help. And for everyone else to have those conversations and be like, hey, if you see someone struggling, say something. Talk with them, like reach out, like be that support system. So great guest. That was awesome having him on the show. So let's wrap up the show with another segment of Ask Paul Anything. I have another question here. And again, make sure to email your questions in to actionsandlimits@gmail.com to have your questions featured on the show. So there is a question here. This is from Lisa in Texas. Let's say where. Says, Paul, if you could make a rule for a day and everyone had to follow it, what would it be?
If I could make a rule that everybody had to follow, it would be is you can't use the word can't.
Okay. Just for the day. Just for one day.
Well, you told me I could only do it for one day, right? I mean, I would like to do it forever, but for one day, it would be, yeah.
But that one, you can't use the word can't.
you can't use the word can't. That would be my rule. That word does not exist for the day.
What would the repercussions of that be for the day?
I would say a hefty slap on the hand with a ruler.
No, I mean like what would that create for everyone?
Oh, I thought you wanted to know what the punishment would be.
No. What would that create for everyone, you know, if we had to follow that rule for a day?
I think it would help people think about things differently. You know, the first thing we think about when we have a problem that we don't really understand, our first instinct to say is, I can't do that. Mm. Well, is it because you don't want to do it? I mean, you know, what is the real reason why you're saying the word can't? It's just, you're just putting a limit on you, like we talk about. You're putting a limit on you by saying you can't. So
yeah.
We're all about actions and limits here, and, you know, that's definitely a limit.
I got it. I like it, Paul. You know, removing that word from our vocabulary. Hopefully, maybe we can do it for more than one day, right? You know.
Yeah. But, yeah. But I only have the power for one day.
You're right. Okay, you only get the power. Only one day. You only get that one day, Paul.
Yeah.
But again, thank you for submitting your question for Ask Paul Anything. Really good show today, Paul. Our guest, you know, had a lot to share, and I hope he keeps, you know, his passion, his mission alive. So great show.
Absolutely. For Justin Atherton, this is Paul Fortune. We'll see you next week.
All right. See you next Monday. Thank you for listening to the show. Remember to leave a comment and tell us what you thought about today's episode. Follow us on your favorite podcast platforms. We're on Apple, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, TuneIn, and featured on Podbean. Follow us on Instagram at ActionsandLimits. And stay updated on all the upcoming content. If you have any outrageous questions for our section Ask Paul Anything, submit them to actionsandlimits@gmail.com and your question could be featured on the show.